happy to hear that you
do. I like that better. How did you come up with water?
Well, if you've ever seen
it. First of all, you are fabulous. You should even use yourself.
Thank you.
She has been doing great things in this town far before I got here. That's true.
Don't believe the hype, ladies and gents. Don't believe the hype.
Yes, you have.
I want to ensure, before we continue, Lynn, but are we recording this?
This is good. This is for your podcast, Turning the Tables. My name's Corey Booker, by the way.
I was going to introduce him. I promise.
I need an introduction.
He needs an introduction. Let's give Senator Corey Booker a round of applause. Live podcast. So he's talking.
I've never done a live podcast.
I have. I just did one last week with Gabrielle Jolene and Lisa Meeting.
Okay, so that's pretty high. Now you're coming down.
No, this is great. This is great. Was awesome, and it was an amazing podcast. You should have it when we have downtime, whenever that might be.
Okay.
Whenever.
I'm a podcast enthusiast.
Oh, okay.
And I have changed my recent workout to music, but now I work out with a podcast or a audio book.
Nice. I don't know if I can make it through an audio book workout, but I do like audio books.
So how are you doing on? Like, you go on CNN, people come in.
So that's where On One came from. To go back to your first question.
Because I have to say, I love watching you. Just to see you get it as well as you get it.
Thank you. It's been an interesting ride. There used to be a time where you could go on TV and talk about politics and strategy, what's happening on the news.
And issues.
And now you're arguing about, like, are there really clouds in the sky? And then you have to have a debate about whether or not that's fake news.
And by the way, do you think that that's a reason? Is that a symptom or a contributing factor to gridlock in Washington?
No, I think that has to do with your president.
Okay. Yeah. Well, why did you say my president?
Because he's not my president.
He's the president of the United States of America.
He's not my president. My president left office on January 20th. Okay. Yeah.
So when the next president, you're going to be the one that wants other folks to call the president of the United States.
Perhaps. And reasonable minds can disagree. Unreasonable minds can too, but I am, like, dug in, it's not happening. He's the president, he's not my president.
Okay, but going back to the point, when you were on CNN when President Obama was there, it was just as vicious and mean and lack of substantive policy issues. I listened to a Twitter clip. Really?
No.
I listened to Secretary Clinton being interviewed, and she was like, she stuck me with a data point about how little amount of time do news media talk about policy.
Yeah.
And how much time they talked about anything nonsense, just what he tweeted, and things like that.
I think that some of that might be fair, but I don't think we were at a point where it was like, well, what's the fact?
Right, that's
true. It was a little bit different.
Yes, I agree with you.
So since I have you for a short amount of time, I want to do kind of like a rapid fire round and then get into some of the other very important issues that you all are facing.
And so this podcast came out of?
So it really came out of the fact, you talked about cable news. And we're on segments that are so short. And folks kept saying, what were you going to say if you weren't on? What were you going to say if they didn't go to commercial? And people kept saying, why don't you have a podcast? Why don't you have a podcast? And I was like, I don't know if I want to do that. I don't even listen to podcasts. The truth is terrible. But that's what I said. So then I was like, well, maybe it would be healing for me. Because right now I am crushed around the election and the results were devastating. And so it really has become healing. It's been a way to kind of talk to reasonable minds. Folks were doing amazing work. We spent a lot of time talking to people about resistance strategy, one of the things I want to talk to you about just to get your feedback on. And it's been a way to, I think, really unify some folks in the community, some who know each other and some who don't.
So I'll stop being a difficult guest.
Thank you!
With the exception of this.
Yeah.
So you and I have had this conversation privately, and I'll say publicly, you should have a podcast. So if you're one of those people that needs to be on TV more, because I love that you try to fight to bring it back to the facts that are important for people. And so I know you have a lot of guests, but I think the conversations that we have, because I know you before when you were working with the CDC and others, I just think that you have such a substantive understanding of issues and policy. I'm very happy that you are a voice. But you also, I have to say, make it fun to watch in terms of just the way you grapple with the best of it.
Thank you so much. I wish that it was a pleasure all the time, but it can be frustrating. And the thing that encouraged me the most is that there are people who look like me, some who don't. Older people, younger people, folks in other countries who say that they feel like I speak for them. And that is humbling, and I'm grateful for that. I just hope that we get He was like, you can hold them for me, and then I'll sit
down. I would like one of those bags, but I cannot take these. Those are like very fancy bags.
Oh, those are swaggy bags.
Swag bags.
We are now going to continue with this podcast. I think I might be getting filibustered for the first time by Senator Booker, because you know that's the thing. And there's a loud truck happening. So anyway, rapid fire. I want to know what your favorite food was before you became a vegan.
Well, before I became a vegan, I was a vegetarian for 22 years.
Okay.
So I'm not
going
to give
you... 22 years before you were a vegan, or 22 years before you were a vegan, what was your favorite food?
I would still say, so these are the I still eat the same food.
This is not right.
Okay, pizza, hamburgers,
please tell me
ice cream, cupcakes, cookie dough. I'm not talking about cooked cookie dough. I'm talking about getting you some here, sit me down in front of some good TV, and let me eat the whole tube, and then wonder what happened to the tube.
So, do you ever miss the cookie dough?
They have vegan cookie.
Oh, he has
look at the young lady,
dough.
She's like,
ooh,
she's
delicious.
She gave me this look.
Yeah, I'm giving you a look.
But I'm telling you right now, vegan cookie dough is actually healthy because it's not raw eggs.
Okay,
vegan
he's
not.
He's
not going to
sell us on this, and this is rapid fire. Okay,
so go ahead.
The next thing.
Okay.
What is your favorite TV show?
I do not have a favorite TV show. I'm sorry, I'm not going to be quiet. Look, I'm dying. I am right now at home saved on my DVR the entire Game of Thrones.
Okay.
I'm dying to go home, but I can binge watch Game of Thrones.
Like from the very beginning or
no,
just
no,
this
no, just this season. Okay. And I hear everybody tell me it's phenomenal TV.
Okay.
And I just have not had a chance over the last 5 or 6 weeks to go home and watch these episodes.
I'm scared of Game of Thrones. They were pushing people down into this hole and they never saw where they went. I'm scared to watch it.
Don't tell them. Just...
No, that's not this season. That was like over or 2 seasons ago or so. They were pushing people that. Niece of the auntie, and then she was messing with the uncle. It's nasty, too. I can't. Anyway, Game of Thrones. Do you have a favorite Ratchet television show? This is
Mr.
Ratchet podcast.
I do not have a favorite.
Not telling y'all. He probably
watched
basketball
while
I was living.
No. I have to say, a friend of mine got an argument over basketball. I just worry sometimes.
All right, we're not going down that road. Okay. What would give me something that folks would be surprised to learn about me?
Well, you put out there vegan stuff.
Okay, well then that's not a surprise. You made a new surprise.
A new surprise that people do not know about me. I love to meditate.
Loves to meditate.
I think that that's really been a grounding force in my life. Has helped me. My father used to say that there's two ways to live life. You can use a thermometer or a thermostat. And a thermometer just reacts to the world around you, stimulus response, but a thermostat sets the temperature. And meditation has been one of those gifts. It's helped me to set my temperature, try to radiate that energy, that warmth, that kindness, no matter what the environment is around.
That's awesome. So we're not getting anything ratchet from the senator, y'all. He's vegan. Never drink alcohol in his life. Baby Jesus, right here, ladies.
Yes,
baby
never.
Jesus. Even Jesus had red wine. I mean, well, at least he turned water into wine.
I just confessed to my cookie dough addiction.
No, but now it's vegan cookie dough.
Yes.
Which is good for you.
No, empty carbs. I'm serious. There's a great guy.
This is not serious.
Ron Finley. He works in South Central Los Angeles. One of the best TED Talks, if you ever go to Ron Finley, Gorilla Gardener, he says in South Central we got drive-bys and drive-throughs, and the drive-throughs are killing more people than drive-bys.
That's me.
And here we are at the Congressional Black Caucus, African Americans, the death rates of African Americans, in ways that are not seen in other populations, from hypertension, from heart disease, from preventable things, because what we put in our bodies often, as well as other factors, access to healthcare. Black kid is 10 times more likely to die from asthma than a white kid with the same affliction. But I do say that the diets we have as African Americans, and a lot of this is driven by policy. Why can my kids in Newark you want from your bodega, get an Apple product. An Apple is more expensive than a Twinkie product because we subsidize so much of that. We've got to talk about the larger policy issues, access to healthcare. Here we are on the precipice of another Republican bill Trump cared about to pass. But putting all that aside, we have got to figure out ways. And this is why when I was mayor, focused so much about getting rid of food deserts, urban farming, all of these things. You've got to be doing better about making sure we are putting within ourselves things that are going to help us to radiate strength and power and health.
Okay, last rapid fire. You know this has not been so rapid.
It's not so rapid. Now we got some folks stopped.
They still won't sit down.
They won't sit down.
Trying to sit down. This is
well, that's because I know. These people have to know the health benefits of standing up. They really do. Sedentary to stand and watch this podcast.
Okay, well, amen, church. Last right. question. Last rapid fire.
Unless rapid fire.
So Kristen doesn't get too excited. Like, we're running out of here. What is the last song you listen to?
Today?
Maybe if you listen to a song today, you know you like audiobooks, so maybe you listen to a song today.
The last song I listened to, I was doing an interview yesterday with Politico. And I've never had an interview like this. The person wanted to come to me and talk about the fact that I talk about love so much. And then we got into a complicated discussion with you, and I will not agree. And I just, you need to know that I love this one.
So
you know how people you meet professionally, you just have a level of love and adoration for them? But I'm not sure we will agree on this issue. Because we were talking about, he wanted to interview about love.
Mm-hmm.
And I just said to him, I was not going to let anybody pull me down so low that I'm going to hate them. And we started talking about.
What am I going to disagree with?
We were talking about the President of the United States. And I know this is the President.
I think you should not hate human beings.
Thank you. And so after
you can't figure that out.
So I was telling him the story. I was telling him the story.
He just got it.
It took me a moment.
Not hate any human being.
You're I love you. Okay, so this is what I was telling you. I gave my speech at the convention.
Yeah.
And at which point, at the end of the night, my mom ran and said, what an amazing speech. I'm like, thank you, Mom. She goes, no, not you, Michelle Obama. Because I had to go right before Michelle Obama. Yeah. But anyway, I get a tweet from the first time that the president was selected me to tweet me to him.
Yeah.
And which was good because I felt left out in the Senate. He had been mean tweeting everybody from
John. I need to read the mean tweet.
John McCain to Elizabeth Warren.
Yes.
He had mean tweeting about
yes.
everybody. It was an equal opportunity mean tweeter. But finally,
and typos, by
the way. Hey, I'm not going to hate on him for his typos because I might have had one or two of my
two
own.
Or one or two daily. Come on, Stanford. You know you don't have that going on.
So I am suddenly on. The next morning, I'm up early on. Reads the tweet, what your response is, and I'm going to say my response to this is that I love Donald Trump. I don't want to be my president.
No!
I'm not going to let him pull me so
y'all don't let Cory Booker love on Donald Trump in here. Come on.
Listen, he needs some love. Look, if Nelson Mandela can love his jailers, this is where I knew we weren't going to agree. This is where I knew you would sink below the table.
I'm like melting down. Like
my point is this. You cannot be hate with hate. You cannot be darkness with darkness. You gotta bring the light, you gotta bring the love.
No, but you can resist hate.
Oh, I'm gonna fight.
And that's what I'm doing.
I'm gonna resist.
He is the means by which the hate is
and
coming.
And so we should fight, we should resist, we should, right now, all of us should be committing ourselves to the cause of our country, the values we hold dear, to doing everything possible to stop some of the most noxious, harmful policies that are out there. But at the end of the day, I'm not gonna darken my spirit. So I can agree with that.
So I'm gonna work on, I don't think that my spirit is darkening. I just think that you shouldn't hate human beings.
Well, but my soul has darkened. There have been times where I've gotten so angry. I mean, the craven healthcare bills that I've seen, I do not understand how.
I want to talk about healthcare, but do you know you never gave me the last song you listened to?
Well, this gets to the last song. Right? But thank you very much.
You like Migos?
No, now you're getting heckled. You basically are getting, I just got heckled.
Yeah.
I think of all the places I might be
nobody
safe
was like an
not to get heckled was the CBC. No. So this is where I went with the reporter. This is the long story.
Oh,
I started talking to him about the guy who wrote the song Amazing Grace and how.
Now you know good and well that's not the last song you listened to.
Aretha Franklin, Amazing Grace. I put it on this morning on my way into
You did?
Yes.
So he is Baby Jesus. Baby Jesus. Senator Jesus.
You are. The ladies are confessing my sins up here. To let
you
know.
Big and cookie the hall.
Studies show that minority and women were managers in many instances, and in the aggregate of the study that Barclays Bank did, perform better, get better financial returns than some of the big majors. But yet the big majors are the ones in all the federal pension funds who are paid in by diverse people are the ones that get the opportunities to manage this money. This is big business in America. Fortunes are created by those get the privilege of managing pension funds, who are, again, often are paid into. We have unions, hundreds of millions of dollars under management. Their unions are disproportionately minorities, but then they're choosing for to manage this money of firms that don't reflect the diversity of the very people. And so I came down here as a senator almost 4 years ago exactly, and I asked the question, why would the hundreds of billions of dollars under management, why aren't women-run firms or minority firms getting an opportunity to manage it? And so this is what I know. Reverend Al Sharpton said this very pointedly. We live in communities. He's in New York. I think he lives up in Harlem. I live in Newark, New Jersey. And we have folk that are paying money into these pension funds, creating vast amounts of wealth. Then those pension funds are picking managers. Those management companies are investing in real estate organizations. Real estate organizations are coming into our communities and often gentrifying those communities. So you are actually paying for your own demise in terms of your moving out of these communities. And so there's something wrong with this picture. If we can't start making sure that the playing field is not only level so that African Americans, Latinos, and women get a chance to manage it, but you often find those firms then making decisions about their investments that reflect the interests of communities. And so this is one of those things, these vicious circles that people don't understand, how it is absolutely important who is managing money and who gets those opportunities. And so this was the focus of our panelists today.
So a couple of other things that you have been known to talk about, mass incarceration, and of course today you brought up health care a couple of times. We know that Senators Graham and Cassidy have put forward a bill, and I want to go back to mass incarceration. I want to start with the really bad stuff. First, of course, mass incarceration is a positive word here. This bill, they're talking about pulling $215 billion in federal funding immediately from the existing health care system and over, and it ended up cutting $4 trillion. From healthcare. Talk a little bit about what is wrong with this very poisonous bill and what we can count on senators of reasonable minds to do in the wake of this potential legislation.
This is really that moment we saw a weeks ago where John McCain, the very last moment, voted against Trump care, which would have not just, people think this is just about repealing and replacing Obamacare. It's more than that. So it is that. It is taking away protections against people, insurance companies being able to discriminate you because of a pre-existing condition. Ending what I call junk insurance, where somebody's paying for their insurance, but suddenly they get cancer and realize, wait a minute, my insurance doesn't cover hospitalization. My insurance has a lifetime cap where I can't, once I expend a certain amount of money, they stop paying for it. And going back to the days, the number one reason people file personal bankruptcy is, you know, because they can't afford their medical bills. In fact, since the Affordable Care Act, since Obamacare, bankruptcies in the United States have been cut in half. So not only is it reversing all of that, as well as it's also doing more. It's attacking Planned Parenthood, which Actually, many counties and communities like mine are a major portal for people to get access to health care, contraceptive care, to preventative health care. But then it's taking a 52-year-old program, Medicaid, and completely gutting Medicaid. It is putting a cap on Medicaid, which is going to take billions of dollars away from states all around the country and allowing those states to do anything they want, to have a lot large latitude with what they do with the money, which ultimately, as we've seen from the Congressional Budget Office scoring this before, when they've come after Medicaid, it's going to move tens of millions of people off Medicaid. And most people think, oh, this is just for low-income people. Well, first of all, that should be enough. But nearly half of all births in America, our children are covered by Medicaid. Disabled parents, even the parents who are in middle-income parents, it will attack of children's resources with disabilities. More than half of elderly that are in nursing homes. Remember, many of them are forced to pay down their own assets, and then Medicaid kicks in. This is an assault on most Americans. And by the way, when you assault the healthcare of Americans, you're actually hurting all of America. So this is a toxic bill that will take our country back, not just to before Obamacare, but it will take us back decades and decades and decades to undermine the progress that this country has done. And for any of us in this moral moment, you will not be asked to storm beaches in Normandy. You will not be asked to do freedom rides knowing your bus will be bombed and you will be beaten. But this is our moral moment in our country right now. It is astonishing to me that this week, the United States Senate passed a defense bill worth hundreds of billions of dollars that we can get together for the national defense. But yet, just after seeing hurricanes, that we don't understand that we have the defense of this nation isn't just nuclear weapons from a North Korea. It is also the things that challenge us, whether it is a natural disaster or the plague of cancer in our country. This nation founded its government for the national defense, and healthcare should be a fundamental, if we are a nation that believes in life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness, fundamental to those ideals is everyone in our country having access to affordable quality health care.
Sitting here right now because a whole bunch of folk counted it not as robbery
to come out and march and protest and let their voices be heard. This is, I'm telling you, in our lifetime, we may not see a battle as consequential as what will happen in healthcare if this legislation goes through next week.
So I want to switch gears briefly. We know that Senator Rand Paul has been outspoken about this particular measure for different reasons than I think many of us would agree with, but he's against it nonetheless. You have worked with him in the past on issues related to mass incarceration. I'd love for you to tell the growing audience that is standing up for health reasons, as you put it,
yes.
Just a little bit about what you all have done and what you hope to see happen relative to mass incarceration this year going forward.
So look, I mean, because we've so geographically divided ourselves as a country, we don't sometimes grasp how that the greatest cancer on the soul of America is what we have done when it comes to mass incarceration. This is the greatest singular cancer on the soul of our country, a nation that professes to be a nation of liberty and justice for all, that literally on the building of the Supreme Court, it says equal justice under law. And mass incarceration has not been the history of our country. It really was just in the 60s and 70s that we went from being just like our industrial peers to having our incarceration rate go up 800% at the federal level since 1980 alone. And what we've done it is churn unconscionable levels of humanity into our jails and our prisons. Unconscionable levels. One out of every three imprisoned women on the planet Earth are in the United States of America. One out of four people in total incarcerated on the planet Earth are in the United States of America. And who do we incarcerate? I went to Stanford University. They weren't stopping and frisking people coming home from frat parties. The FBI wasn't setting up sting operations to figure out where anybody who's on college campus knows where to get the Adderall or the marijuana or the ecstasy or the cocaine. But the reality is, it is in urban communities, it's in poor communities where this drug war is being carried out. War on drugs is not a war on drugs, it's a war on people. And our jails in America are full of the mentally ill, the addicted, the poor, the low-income folks, and overwhelmingly minorities. And if you just focus on minorities for a second, it has been such a thorough way of effectively cementing the discriminations of the past and the present. There's a universal study that just came out. We'd have 20% less poverty on a whole in our country if we had incarceration rates just like our peers, because you all know this. If you're a 17-year-old and you have a felony conviction, you're doing things that two of the last three presidents have admitted to doing. You now have a 17-year-old felony conviction. Your lifetime earnings drop precipitously. You can't get a job. You can't get a loan from a bank. You can't get a Pell Grant just for doing things that Congress people in private quarters talked about the fact that they've done. We now have more African Americans in this nation under criminal supervision than all the slaves in 1865. And it's destroyed not just economic power, but political power. This war, or so-called war on drugs. Think about this, Florida is the swingiest of swing states, and one out of every five African Americans in Florida cannot vote because of felony disenfranchisement. And where did felony disenfranchisement come from? Go to the record generations ago where states were talking about taking away voting rights because of felony disenfranchisement. Literally in the state debates, they talked about, hey, this is a way for us to stop blacks from voting. Specifically said. And the legacy of that racist policy is the fact that we have Congress people and senators who smoke dope or done drugs, who are serving in the Senate, but who have kids in communities 18, 19, 20 years old that can't vote for doing lesser crimes because they were caught. Because in America, there's no difference between blacks and whites.